Praise the Lord, people of God, we are back once again. Glory, glory to God. We give you all the glory. We want to appreciate God for His mercy and His grace upon our life. So before we continue, I just want us to bow down our heads for a short prayer. Gracious Father, we want to thank you and appreciate you. We want to thank you, Lord God, for this program, our grace. Lord, we pray that you have your way. The purpose will, Lord, be meant in the name of Jesus. We pray that God Almighty, that your will be done in the name of Jesus. Lord Almighty, Ancient of Days, we ask for broadcast. Lord, we pray that people's eyes will be opened to the revelations of Christ in the name of Jesus. We pray that God Almighty, that the veil in people's eyes will be removed. As the Bible says, when the Old Testament is being preached, there is a veil. When Christ is being preached, there is liberty. The veil is taking off people's eyes. That veil taking off people's eyes in Jesus. Thank you, our Father. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, mighty name. Amen. Praise Amen. People of God, we are back once again, and we believe that you have a wonderful week. And today we are going to continue on that same subject, on that same topic, which is Christ, the end of the law. Part 3. We are still going to continue on that today. Christ, the end of the law. So we need to emphasize on this. And that's the reason we are bringing it up and on. We need to emphasize on this. So my name is Pastor Kingsley Amos, and by my left is Minister Usarime Amos, and by my right is Brother Israel. So we are here again to unveil the revelation about Christ. Christ, the end of the law. People of God, if you are out there, I want you to listen very carefully to me. Listen and listen very good. We are not here to insult anyone, no. I'm not after that. I'm not here to insult. And by grace of God, since we have been on this program, we have not talked about any personality, but the Word of God. We have only one doctrine, which is the doctrine of Christ. So when I see insulting other people's doctrine, it means that there are no other doctrines. There's only one doctrine, the doctrine of Christ. Is the church divided? In that doctrine is the doctrine of Christ. And we must all follow that doctrine, because that is the reason why there is chaos in Nigeria. There is chaos in Africa. Because people with different things, we must go. There is one doctrine that has been given to us, and that's the doctrine of Christ. And that's the reason we want to emphasize on Christ, the end of the law, again. Christ, the end of the law. Let me tell you, if you go to the New Testament, because we are New Testament preachers, we are New Testament church. The church was born after His resurrection. And from His resurrection, you will find out in the Bible that there were problems. The Jews were having problems with Christians. What are the reasons? Because why? The Christianity and the law does not go together. The laws of Moses and Christianity were opposites. They fight. And that's the reason why there were persecutions. Persecutions everywhere. Read Acts of Apostles. Just read from when Jesus resurrected. You will find out that it was all persecution. Why? Because Christ has ended the law. And this was the preaching of the early apostles. And that was the reason why they were having problems. There was a time in Acts chapter 6 from verse 7. From if you read down there, the Bible says that there was a breakout of persecution in Jerusalem. And they all scattered abroad, remaining only apostles. Why? Why was there persecution? Because Christ has ended the law. So they were preaching about Christ. They were preaching that Christ resurrected, and which is the law. And so I want you to stay back. Please, we are not We are not here to insult anyone. No, it's just for us to have knowledge. It's painful. It's very painful. It pains me a lot for Africans that you are fighting for people. You are fighting for men, not fighting for God. You are fighting for men. Men is men that established those doctrines. Let's go to the doctrines of Christ. Stop fighting for men. That is the problem we are having in Africa. That is the problem, because when somebody comes up to correct things, you see people began to talk. People began to fight that person. Whereas, instead of you to check very well, is this person saying the truth or not? That's the problem. Have a change of heart. Let's have a change of mind. If we want a change in our lives, if we want a change in the, we all talk about our country. We all talk about our country is not changing. But we don't want to change. When somebody tries to bring the change, we first of all criticize that person. We first of all began to go against that person. Let's check our Bible very well. Read your Bible very well. The churches of God in Africa, especially in Nigeria, where I came from, they are mixing everything, and we must correct issues. I don't care to know. We must correct issues. So long as I stayed on my lane, what God has asked me to do, we must correct issues. And so that is the reason why we brought up this. And we must reach the world with this gospel of Christ. Christ is the end of the law. We must do this. And we are going to show you more. We have been showing you more from the word of God. We are going to show you more today. Praise Master Jesus. So we are going to, I'm going to give time for my brother to speak as well, and to take us to the world as well.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. We are back again, like as Pastor said, that we are not here to tell you that we are more knowledgeable than you, but this is an opportunity for us to hear and echo our own view from the scripture, not from our own five senses or our own doctrine. Anything we are saying, whatever we are saying, we are taking it from the written word. Amen.
Amen.
And if you doubt the written word, especially the New Testament, definitely you are doubting the word of Christ. Mm-hmm. Some people have said that some of these letters were Paul letter, which means that is Paul. I am not Paul, you understand me? Which means you don't believe in the person of the Holy Spirit, because it was the Spirit of God that inspired him to write all those things. So, amen. So, we are still on that Christ, the end of the law. Now, I want to bring our attention to the book of Romans, chapter number 7. If you are listening to me, pay attention. If time will permit, there will be a little bit long reading so that we will understand what the Bible is saying. Romans chapter number 7. I read from verse 1. It says, "Know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them that know the law, how that the law had dominion over a man as long as he lives." Law has dominion over a man as long as he lives. Even in the country where we live, I don't know where you are, there is a law in that country. And as far as you live, that law has dominion over you. Amen. Verse 2, it says, For the woman which had a husband is bound by the law to her husband as long as she liveth. But if the husband being dead, she is loose from the law of her husband. Amen.
Amen.
If her husband being dead, she is loose. She's loose. So then, while her husband liveth, she being married to another man, she shall be called an adulteress. But if her husband being dead, she is free from the law, so that she is no adulteress, though she be married to another man. Amen.
Amen. men.
Paul used the marriage to communicate how law and grace, yes, because I call law and grace is working together, is the two of them. Now, we know, as far as you are a believer, I believe also other religion, other, because we are not religious people, other religion, some of them don't advise to, that's marriage, one wife and one wife. Mm-hmm. So now here it said, as far as that man is alive, the woman is bound by the law of that place. If she go outside that place, she should be called adulteress. Then, but if the man is dead, which means she's free
to marry.
She's free to do what?
To marry.
And when she marry, you will no longer call her an adulteress, because what bound her has died.
Yes.
So, after the resurrection of Christ, mm-hmm, Christ is saying on the cross, it is finished. Law dies. And we became free. We are not free to marry whoever we want to marry. So let's read more so that you understand what I'm saying. Verse 4. Wherefore, my brethren, ye also are become dead to the law by the body of Christ. So when Christ died, that was when the law dies. Amen.
Amen.
That ye should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, that we should bring forth fruits unto God. So the law died with Christ. Amen.
Amen.
And we became free to marry to another. Who did we marry to?
Jesus
Christ. We are the bride, I think. He is the bridegroom. Amen.
Yes.
So he communicated with marriage to the church. Amen.
Amen.
Using marriage for people to understand. Verse 5. For when we were in the flesh, the notion of sins which were by the law did work in our members to bring forth fruit unto death. But now we are delivered from the law that being dead. You know, I say, if these letters that Paul the apostle wrote, if you don't believe it, it's better you carve it out of your Bible and throw it away, because he didn't receive this revelation by man.
So,
I think there's a place he wrote, he said that it was not by the works of the law
at all,
but it's by the revelation of Christ. Now, that we've been delivered from the law that is being dead, wherein we were held, that we should serve in the newness of spirit and not in the oldness of the letter, which is the Old Testament. So, the letter died the day Christ died. Now, we are living a new life. We are no longer in tokens and symbols. They that worship the Lord shall worship in what? In spirit and truth. Amen.
Amen.
I told you, he communicated with marriage.
Yes.
So the law died. Now we are married to Christ in newness of life. So Christ is the end of the law to everyone that believes. Because our former husband died, which was the law. And when somebody bring law and grace to miss it, what you are doing is spiritual adultery.
Yes, that's what you're doing here.
Yes. Because if you are in the law and you went after us to the grace, remember you are married to the law.
Yes.
You are going to commit adultery. If you are in the grace and you go to law, remember your husband, we are dead. Now you marry to grace and you go back again, which means you are an adulteress. It's what Paul is communicating here. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
So, Christ ended the law. He is the end of the law. Let me pause there so that somebody, because of
praise Master Jesus. Oh, glory, glory to God. Viewers back home, are you getting this? Are you getting this? Romans chapter 7, do you get what is written there? Paul is Paul is so wonderful. I love that man so much. I love him so much because he tried to communicate with physical things that you can understand.
Yes.
What he communicated now is a physical thing, a woman. We are the women. We are the bride. The bride of Christ. Then now, there was a husband which is not dead the moment Christ died. That's the reason why he came. He came to fulfill it and he died. He died without law. So the law died. The husband, that law that was our husband before, died. Now, he said you are not free to marry another husband because that one is dead. But if he's alive, he said when you go to marry another one, you are an adulteress. But being that that one is dead, you are very free to marry another, which is who? Jesus Christ. So Christ, because Christ has ended that chapter. We are to marry Jesus. Jesus Christ is the beginning of a new era. The born again man. And which you have to live by faith. Do you know why we are bringing all these things? So that, because your thinking, it affects your life. Your belief systems affect your life. It affects the way you think. It affects your daily activities. It affects whatever you do. And that's the reason why we need to change our mind. That's the reason why you need to understand the word of God clearly so that you can apply those things in your life and it will work for you. And it will be so simple. Praise Master Jesus. So let's hear from you as well.
Praise Master Jesus.
Amen.
The word is so thick and so powerful.
Yes.
Word of God. Sometimes when you thought you are no God, as the word said, the more you go, the more you see that you are just going, you are just starting.
Yes.
Praise God.
Amen.
It so much pains me that those that does not study the Bible are the ones that run their mouth.
Run their mouth.
Instead of you to go and see, not somebody telling you, you go there and see yourself. Somebody tell you something. This color is so whatsoever. You go there, check it. Check it out. Instead of you to check out, you will begin to think otherwise, which is not of God. I believe that is the spirit of unbelieving spirits. Believe that they are in the church, but they are unbelievers. Unbelieving believers in the church.
Yes.
Because when the word of God is, because the word of God is so sweet that even as my brother was reading it just now, I begin to see something inside. There is a way my spirit is.
Something is spoken in you.
You understand? And later when I now see people that they now begin to look as if they are in the water leaf, when the sun is rising, they begin to fall. I don't have that over their Christianity. Only what I know that they have zeal but without knowledge. They have zeal without knowledge. What the place it just gave to us and make us to know that the law is already hidden.
Dead.
Jesus has taken over.
Mm.
But we still choose to go ourselves. You understand? They don't want to go to where they're supposed to be. That is the problem we are having.
Mm.
I think John 8:36 says. So John 8:36, yes. We need to be set free. Jesus has set us free. Be born free into the presence of God. Let us be in that presence.
John 8:36. Yes.
He says, so if the Son set you free, you will be free indeed. How many of you know that Jesus has set you free? That is no more your work again. You that is talking about others, he is saying this one, you are reading Bible like whatsoever. Read the Bible and understand what is written there. Praise Master Jesus. Many doesn't want to study. When you don't want to study, you know why? I believe that when I was reading today, I saw that the reason why Paul told the women that they should be quiet in the church, I believe because they don't know it. Because they don't know, they want to ask. And that is not the time to ask. There are time for everything.
Yes.
It doesn't mean because God, Paul wrote that women should be quiet, silent in the church. All it means that we should just relax. Everybody are God created. We are his son. As we have accepted Jesus, you have a new life. Be born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible. That live and abide forever. What are you doing? If you, the more you look at other people error without you don't knowing it, would you first of all go to what they are bringing to you? When you check it, you not check it with the word. You not see that there is a difference on it. But without you checking the word, how will you not know if there is different in that word that you are saying? Praise Master Jesus. I think that's the same Roman where our brother read. Romans 6 verse 2. Let's see Romans 6 verse 2.
God forbid, how shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein?
Okay, let's go to 6. That's Romans 7, 6. 6 of it.
7, 6.
Okay, that is where, no, that is where you read just now. Praise Master Jesus. Amen. That is Romans 6, 6, 6. Let's see what is there.
6, 6, 6. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that by that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin.
Praise Master Jesus. When you don't know where you are coming from, you serve sin. You still serve sin. Praise Master Jesus. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him. With who? With Jesus. Where you read just now, you talk about husband and wife. How when a woman is got married to a man, he need to abide with that law. The problem we are having, that is, I'm just want to a little bit divert. The problem we are having in marriage today is because sometimes when you, those that have married, they still want to do things on their own. They still want to take advice from outside. When two of you are now one, anything you want to do is supposed to be. That is the problem we are having. I just divert a little. But this place makes us to understand that knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, with Jesus, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. When you are now in the Old Testament, you are serving sin. You are nurturing sin. Or because those things that they ask you not to do, it's just like a child. Tell it a child now, this Bible, don't open it if I'm not here. He will tell you, okay. He's just waiting for you to go. That thing that makes you to tell him not to open it, he wants to see it. The more you go to love, the more people wear away. The more they fell asleep. The more they get weak car every day. But when you give them the word, which they fight, Jesus has fought the fight. He won. Jesus is a winner. He has won the fight, and then you don't have need to fight for yourself now. You're not wearing clothes. You're not wearing shoes. You going like that, tying your hair. That is, it's just the shadow. It's you living the right thing and pursuing shadow. Jesus has fought the fight. The fight is already over. When you embrace him, you are a new man. A new thing has taken place in your life. You have no power, or the enemy has no power over you again. He said it just now, where we read that. When the man died, the woman is free. When Jesus go, that there was freedom. When Jesus came, when the Lord God, Jesus came, they were free. As many that I embraced Jesus, that freedom is upon their life. Praise Master Jesus. Then we're supposed to read it down there no more so that we can see things. We come back again.
Praise Master Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Viewers back home, this is so interesting. This is so interesting because sin is connected to the law. The Bible says in Romans chapter 3, verse 20, it says, for the knowledge of sin is the law.
Of course, that law is not sin.
Law, that's Romans chapter 3, verse 20. Law is the knowledge of sin. So now, when the Bible talks about Romans here, Romans chapter 6, talking about the body of sin, and it's talking about the law. Because law, now, if you check where we read, just now, Romans chapter 7, verse 6. Romans 7, 6. Say, but now we are delivered from the law. Now we are delivered. Do you see it now? You need to be delivered from the law. Because law is a bondage. Now, 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 now. Now, I'm emphasizing on that. I said, now we have delivered from delivered, not delivery, not maybe it has happened. It has taken place. Now we have delivered from the law that being dead, wherein we are headbound, that we should serve in newness of spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. Now, I want to take you little to that letter. That letter is talking about the Old Testament. Now, let's see 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Talking about the oldness of the letter. The oldness of the letter. The letter, anywhere you see the letter, it's talking about the Old Testament. Now, let's see 2 Corinthians chapter 3. I'll read 2 Corinthians, I will be 1 Corinthians. Just from verse 1 or from verse 3. Read from verse 3.
For so much as we are manifestly declared to thee the epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in the table of stone, but in the fleshly table of the heart. And such trust have we through Christ towards you.
Verse 5.
Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God.
6.
Verse 6. Who also had made us able ministers of the New Testament, but not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit maketh alive.
For the letter, you see, Romans said just now, oldness of the letter. Now here say, for the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. If you compare these two scriptures now, he said that we should be in the newness of life. In that Romans chapter 7, the newness of life, not of the oldness of the letter. Now here say, he said, for the letter killeth. Now that verse 6 says, he said, who had made us able ministers of the new, not of the Old Testament, not of the law. We are able ministers of the New Testament. Like as I can boldly say it anywhere. I am a gospel that's Christocentric, New Testament, a minister of the New Testament. Because that's what everyone, if you are preaching Christ, that is what you are supposed to be. You are not supposed to be preaching the law. Because when you are preaching the law, you are preaching death to people. You are preaching the law, you are preaching veil to people. And so therefore, you need to change out of that. You need to get out of that place. Then because why? You are preaching dead, a dead husband. Because the law is already dead. It's a dead husband. You are preaching the dead husband. It's not going to preach to the life, the one that is alive, which is Christ Jesus. Praise Master Jesus. So now he says, for the spirit, for the letter killeth. It kills. He said, we have been delivered from the law. Because why? It kills. If you read down in this place, you will find out that now verse 7, if you are following, I want us to read this place carefully. Verse 7 says, but if the ministration of death, you know, you see what they call it? The law is ministration of death. If the ministration of death, written and engraved in stones, was glorious. So there is a glory in the law as well. There's no doubt about that. There's a glory in it. He said, was glorious. So that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses. For the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, was to be wiped away. How shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? It's more glorious. It's more glorious. The ministration of the Spirit is more glorious than the ministration of death. One night it was called the ministration of death. Now listen to that one again. Verse 9. For if the ministration of condemnation, that's on that one again. Second one again. That's on that name again. The ministration of condemnation. If the administration of condemnation be glory, much more the administration of righteousness exceed in glory. So therefore, the law, when you're preaching the law, you are not preaching righteousness. Here says it. And I can show you in so many places. You're not preaching the righteousness. Because the righteousness of God is Christ Jesus. So when you preach Christ, because some of us, we hide under the umbrella that we are preaching Christ, but preaching the law. You hide under the umbrella, I believe in Jesus, but you are all your preaching is about the law. All your preaching is in the Old Testament. And you cannot even unfold. If you are, there's, I preach from the Old Testament, but I make sure that I reveal Christ in that place. Anywhere you see me, if I preach in the Old Testament, when I take you to the Old Testament, I must make sure Christ is revealed there, because it was all about Christ. Last week, I told you so many places that was talking about Christ. All we're talking about Christ. So you have to reveal Christ anywhere if you are preaching, because you must preach from the Old Testament, because that Old Testament was the fulfillment, that's to fulfill the new, and that's the reason why the new. And so when you preach, because even the apostles were preaching from that Old Testament, but they were preaching Christ from that Old Testament. And so when you preach the Old Testament, you must be able to preach Christ from there. If you cannot preach Christ from there, putting people in bondage, then you are not worthy to be the minister, the New Testament. You are not worthy to be the minister of God. You need to change your mind. You need to get to know that the law has ended. Now, we walk by faith and by the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God. Because the Old Testament is a veil. If you read down here, you find that the Bible says it was a veil. First of all, he called it ministration of death. Secondly, he called it ministration of condemnation. Now, thirdly, he calls it another name again. Okay? Then now, verse 11. Condemnation. He called it ministration of condemnation. Verse 11. If that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. Seeing then that we much have much hope, we use great plainness of speech. 13. And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is
abolished.
How will I explain this? I'm seeing it in everywhere. Anywhere I read it, I see it there. Abolished. And now, Christ, you cannot preach both together. You can't preach both together. It brings chaos. Chaos. Jesus warned us. He said you cannot mix the old wine and the new wine together. When you mix these two together, it will burst in chaos. So people of God, I want us to get this. Christ, let's reveal Christ. Let's know about Christ. Because when you know about Christ, you know about yourself. Because the law was ended. The law died the moment Christ died. And a new thing emerged when he resurrected. That's why I say we are more than the redeemed. We are born again, new creation. Hallelujah. Praise must to Jesus. So I think let's hear from you again.
Amen.
14, okay. Hold on, he said we should read 14. 14 of that second prayer. 14 says, but their minds were blinded. For until this day remained the same veil untaken away in the readiness, in the reading of what? The Old Testament. Which veil is done away in Christ? Which veil is done away in Christ? which veil is done away in Christ. Which veil is done away in Christ. Christ, the end of the law, is to be done away in Christ.
Hallelujah. Amen. Verse 15 still says something there. It says, but even until this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their hearts. My goodness.
Not upon their face because
of the things. No, it's in their eyes. Inside. The veil. He said, when Moses is read, what is Moses? What is Moses? The law. When Moses is read, the veil is upon their hearts. Then verse 16. Nevertheless, when he shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. I speak to you today that that veil that has been placed in your heart is taken away in the name of Jesus. That veil is taken away in the name of Jesus. When Christ shines, because Christ is the glorious light. When Christ shines in your heart, that veil is taken away. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Father, we thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I'm so excited. Brother, let's hear from you.
Let's finish now.
It's not
okay. Okay. 17. So take it.
Okay, nice. 17. 16 said, nevertheless, when it's been turned to the Lord,
yes,
the veil shall be taken away. He said, now, the Lord is that spirit. And where the spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, liberty, emancipation from bondage.
Hallelujah.
From the bondage of the law. Amen. But we all, with an open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into. Which means you don't behold Lord
at all.
You behold the glory of the Lord, are changed
into the same
image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Amen.
Hallelujah.
You know, time won't permit us. But I want us to go back to that Romans 6:6 you read. Read the 7 and Amen.
Amen.
He said, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that. Do you know why he said is crucified? Not what? Because the Bible says, for God so loved the world that whosoever that believeth. So if you believe today, what happened to the man that believed 20 million years ago? What happened to you?
Exactly.
So he said, know ye not that our old man who is crucified. So if you can crucify your old man today, the same salvation a man of 10,000 years ago is available. Amen.
Amen.
And I said that the body of sin might be destroyed. Henceforth we shall not serve sin. He said, for he that is dead is freed from sin, which is the law.
Yes.
How will you die? Now, if we being dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Knowing that Christ being risen from the dead dieth no more, death has no more dominion over him. That death, remember when we read in that 2 Corinthians, said the ministration of death. You know, we, as we used to say, Judah Christianity, whenever sometimes we read this place, some people will believe it's talking about the natural death when this body is old. He said here, the ministration of death, which means somebody can be walking on the street, but he's dead. Because he's receiving the ministration of the dead, which means he's dead.
Yes.
Amen. Death has no power, which means the law has no power over you.
Again.
As the Romans 7 said, when thy husband is dead, she's no longer under the law of her husband. She's made free. So, knowing that Christ being risen from the dead, from the law, you know he is the fulfillment of the law, dieth no more. death has no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. So when you leave the law and come to grace, amen, you live unto God and you live for everlasting. Amen.
Amen.
Like as I said, time won't permit us because we Paul use the marriage to illustrate here. Yes, now let's go to Galatians 6.
I'm just meditating and thinking.
Galatians 6. Yes. I want to, because of time, okay, let's read from verse 13. He said, for either they themselves who are circumcised keep the law, but desire to have you circumcised, that they may glory in your flesh. Now, here was talking about the Jews were emphasizing in the physical circumcision. But Paul tried to let them know that the physical, the fleshly circumcision has nothing to do anymore. That the day a man is born again, he has been circumcised in the spirit, which is the main circumcision a man needs. Amen.
Amen.
You remember Jesus said, I have many things to tell you, that you can't bear. So when the Spirit of God began to reveal some things to Paul, some of them were surprised. If you check it, Matthew, Mark, Luke, I think John, were the four Gospels of Christ. Is it not? But how many letters did Paul wrote? More than four. Interpreting that four Gospel. Amen. Now, verse 15. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision availeth any more anything, nor uncircumcision, but the new creation.
New creation.
So Paul squeezed law and legalism, tradition, he squeezed it. He said, whether you are circumcised or you are not circumcised, as far as you have received the Lord Jesus Christ, you are saved. Amen.
Yes.
It is over. He said here, and as many as walk according to this rule, peace be upon them and mercy upon the Israel of God. He said, from henceforth, let no man trouble me. Don't tell me to go and circumcise for me to have relationship with God. No, let no man trouble me. Don't tell me to go and offer sacrifice. It has been ended. There is no more sacrifice. The day Christ died, God received the sacrifice of God once, and that was all. Amen. He said, let no man do what troubles me. For I bear in my body the mark of the Lord Jesus. Brethren, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Be with your spirit. Amen. You know, when you read this from verse 1, you understand what Paul was communicating. Like as you said, when we started, there was a lot of persecution when, after the resurrection of Christ, when church began, the Jews, you know, even when Jesus was on the earth, the Bible says he was teaching with the Pharisees and the Sadducees.
Yes.
The power of God was present to him, but none of them was healed because they were looking at him. Imagine the son of Joseph the carpenter. Even a poor carpenter, he is claiming to be the Lord. Who are you? Who told you? Where did you get that? My friend, leave this place. You see, they did not know. So Paul, by revelation, is trying to communicate something that all those do this, do that, that Christ has ended all those things. when we know we cannot do it, he died for us so that he can do it for us. He did it for us.
Yes.
So how are we not justified by believing in him that has done it for us? Who ended the law? So I am talking to somebody there. If you are still believing in circumcision to be a medium, which you have a covenant with God, that means the ministration of death is still on your face. Veil is still covered your face.
It's covering the heart.
Yeah, your heart. Amen. So circumcision you need is receiving the lordship of Jesus Christ. You have been circumcised in the spirit. You are now circumcised. God has already, you already are part of the body of Christ. The fleshly circumcision ended here because the Bible said flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. If the fleshly circumcision has something to do with God, why when a man is 80 or 90 years, he died and go back to the dust? You understand?
Yes.
But we have the spiritual circumcision that liveth forever. Amen.
Amen.
Because of time.
Amen. Praise the Lord. You will speak. Praise Master Jesus. This is a very glorious one. And I want to say this now. Okay, if, you know, he said, Paul says here, he says, say, trouble me not. In circumcision, just name them. There are so many things. It's not only, it's just circumcision he said here now. There are so many other things that we stated in the law, which some of us still do. Like, for example, first fruits.
Seed offering,
raising altar, tithing with the crops, all these things, raising an altar, all these things are found in the law, breaking of curses and all that, generational curses, all these things are found in the law. In Christ, there is no generational curses, there is generational blessings. Or you don't tie your hair, or you get trousers. Or you don't wear earring, or you wear earring, or you don't wear gold, you don't wear those things. Those things has nothing to do with God. People of God, those things has nothing to do with God. Your heart. Even in the Old Testament, there were many times that it was emphasized. Your heart. Not the physical things. Your heart. He said God looks the heart. God does not look the physique of a man. He does not look the outward of a man. He looks the heart. You can tie all your hair, and yet your heart is dirty. You are not accepted. You can wear all your just like my wife now, this is so long to the down. You can wear all that. If the heart is dirty, you are not accepted. So, because why? Those things does not count in Christ. It's good for us to dress fine, but it does not count in Christ. What counts in Christ is your heart, the circumcision of the heart. So let's hear from you.
The time has gone. Yeah, let me quickly just read one. That is Galatians 3. We are going to read only 19, if it's possible, 19 and 20. We are going to read the rest
next week.
Yeah, we can leave it next week. Praise God. Galatians 3:19 says, wherefore then serving the Lord, it was added because of transgressions. Till the seed should come. Who is the seed?
Christ.
Even though we did not finish reading, that you serving law, walking in law, it was for a moment, not for eternity.
No.
Things have changed until the seed come. As the seed are we still waiting for the seed to come, or it has already come?
Yes, come.
Then what are we saying? Where are we going to? Why did men always like to do things on their own? When Jesus has born us into a freedom, into the presence of God, through his Lord, why are we still trying to do things on our own? I don't know why men always like walking, right from day one. They like to walk. But grace, it is well.
Yeah. Praise Master Jesus. Do you know why I was smiling just now? There were words that was said
and something popped up in me and I began to smile. That grace, some people, I see people writing in Facebook and all that people use all the name of grace. Do you know who is grace? The era you are now is grace. So when you talk that people are using grace to, no, don't do that again, because grace is Jesus. When you say grace, you're talking about Jesus. When you say grace, you're talking about Jesus. So stop. These are opposite things. The law or the grace. Which part are you? The law or the grace? There's nothing like, there is the law or the grace. Choose one. The law or the grace. This is a husband. The law is a husband. Grace is a husband. You have to choose one. You must not be in the two. Because if you are in the two, you are an adulteress. Stop. Don't stop. Stop it. Don't begin to fight for men and yet you are fighting God. Like we all know Paul. That was why I was smiling just now. We all know Paul. Paul was fighting for God. He was killing people. He was thinking he was fighting for God. Grace. If you don't talk about grace, because when you talk about grace, grace is Jesus. Say all the name of grace. Grace is Jesus. Now, John chapter, we'll round up there. John chapter 1. John chapter 1, I think it's 16. Or 18, I think so. No, 16. I think 16.
And of his fullness have all we received the grace for grace.
Of his fullness, there's 17.
For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ.
So if you are a Jesus preacher, what you'll be preaching is Jesus and truth. Grace and truth. Which is Jesus. If you are for Jesus, listen now. If you are for Jesus, what you should be preaching is grace and truth. Because that is Jesus. He said the law came through Moses. But grace and truth came through Jesus. So when you say grace, there's people there. You are talking about Jesus. You're not afraid. You're not afraid. You're talking about Jesus. Grace is Jesus. And everyone should preach grace. That's what everyone needs to preach. Because we are in the dispensation of grace. Paul calls it the dispensation of grace. Grace and truth came through Jesus. Jesus is the grace of God. Jesus is the truth. And so, don't just begin to be cursed people or whatsoever you are. Lack of knowledge. Don't hear. Because the grace of God is Jesus. So I want to appreciate you, even for even watching and for listening. Viewers over there, I want you to know this, that we want this knowledge to spread. We want this thing, we want that faith to be out from people's hearts. I want the veil to be out. I want to shift your mind from physical things. Time will not permit us. We are supposed to go to some physical things like 1 Peter 3:3 that talks about clothing and all that. 1 Timothy 2:9 that talks about clothing. And even 1 Corinthians 11 that talks about tying of the hair and those things. Maybe next week we'll go to those places. Let's talk about some physical things. I want to shift your mind from those physical things. Jesus, the things of Jesus has to do with spiritual things. And he has to be spiritual. He said, they that must worship him in spirit and in truth. Because law is about physicality. Law is about flesh. Law is about the physical things. That's why people go to mountains. That's why people go to valley. They go to different things. Some they even like something. I was talking to a brother last time. And which one they will bring up that topic as well. The errors in the church. Trying to bring up a symbol, an image, that's Christ. That's not Christ. A symbol. They say it's a symbol of Christ. My brother, if you begin to go for that, you are getting it wrong. You are going astray. We'll get to that. So people of God, we're rounding up right now because our time is up. And I want us to know that we are not here to say that we know too much, but we are here to do the will of God. We are here to do what God has sent us to do. We are here to open people's eyes. We are here to remove that veil that is in the heart. We are here to remove it. And if you are not born again, do you want to be born again? You want to be born again. You want to be part of this kingdom. You want to be part of Christ, and you are there. Just say these few words after me. Lord Jesus, I have known that I'm a sinner. Even if you are part of the law, you want to be part of Christ. You want to be part of that husband that is alive because the law is dead already. Your husband is dead already. Now you want to be married to the living one. I want you to say after me, Lord Jesus, I have come to you wholeheartedly. I have come to you. Wash away my sins. Wash away my iniquities. Lord Almighty, have mercy on my unbelief. Have mercy on my lack of knowledge. I want to restrict my life with you. And come and dwell in me. In the name of Jesus. Come and dwell in me. Come and tabernacle in me. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And I pray for you today that wherever you are, may the Spirit of God overshadow you like never before in the name of Jesus. May every darkness in you be gone right now in the name of Jesus. I release the power of God from you, from wherever you are now. I release the power of God. May the power of God hit you now. May the power of God hit you now. May the power of God hit you now. In the name of Jesus. Are you there? You are believing God for a miracle. Receive your miracle right now. In the name of Jesus. Are you there? You are believing God for a testimony. A greater testimony. Receive that testimony right now. In the name of Jesus. Are you there? You are sick in your body. Receive your healing right now. Receive your healing right now. The Bible says he took away our pains. He bore our sickness upon himself. He nailed it on the cross. And therefore, I stand upon that word right now. I release the power of God upon you now. Be healed in your body. Be healed in your bones. Be cleansed in your blood. In the name of Jesus, you tumor, you powers of the pit of hell that is disturbing that woman, that is disturbing that man, I command you right now. I charge you right now to be out. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Abba Father. And those, oh Lord, that are having challenges in their marriage, I release peace. I release peace. I release peace. I release peace. I release joy. May you reign in joy. May you reign in peace. In the name of Jesus. Those believing for the fruit of the womb, I release it right now. May the power hit that womb right now. May the power hit that womb right now. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Abba Father. Thank you, Ancient of Days. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
Oh, glory, glory to God. We believe that God has done something great, friends and well-wishers and those that have been watching. I want to appreciate every one of you. I want to tell you that God is about to do a great thing in our lives. And those that are sharing, I want to encourage you. I want to say, keep on sharing. We are all doing the gospel together. Share this. Share it to everyone. Keep on sharing because we are doing the gospel together. We want to reach the world together. And I want to appreciate you. I want to let you know that your works will never be in vain.
Amen.
The works of God that we all are doing together will never be in vain. I appreciate every one of you. Those that are watching, I appreciate you. Even those that are trying to support in one way or the other, I want to appreciate every one of you. I want to say thank you for your support. I appreciate you. And the Lord appreciates you the more. And if you don't have a place of worship, this is Reigning by Grace Ministries in Fuenlabrada, Madrid. You don't have a place of worship, you want to know, you want to be part of us, you can visit us at Calle Honduras, number 3, Fuenlabrada. It will be written on the screen with the numbers. Or you want to make comments, you want to ask questions, you can as well do that. You can as well call us, you can as well write, we will get to us. We can as well, we always treat everyone, any question that anyone asks, we always treat it. And so, you want to ask questions, please don't hesitate to do that. Contribution, don't hesitate to do that. And I want to appreciate every one of us. You want to visit us, visit us at Kaine, Honduras number 3. It's very close to police station. Our police station here is very, very close to it. And I know that God Almighty is doing great things in our lives. And those, we have a lot of program. We have an association dealing that is about the things of Spain, the how to do so many things here. You want anything that you need an advice, you need a legal advice concerning papers, concerning children, concerning anything, nationality, concerning anything that you want to know about in Spain, anything at all, you can as well call us. We will give you advice, very strong one, and we will help you out. And so I want, we have so many programs. We have that program that we do night as well. We pray from 12 to 1. You want to be part of that too? You can as well still call. And I know that God Almighty will richly bless each and every one of us. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. And keep on reigning by grace.